cry. You can rely on me, honey.
Well, welcome everyone to the AxPx podcast, conversations about faith, doubt, disbelief, and everything in between. I am your host, Sean Drager. Thanks for tuning into the podcast, and today with me, someone I've been wanting to get on the show for quite some time and really excited that it finally worked out, Daniel G. Harmann. What's up, man?
How's it going?
Good. Good. I'm glad to have you on the show. We met on Twitter or something like that.
The Twitter, did someone did Brian send you the record?
I want to say it was almost before that. Maybe I was trying to do the... there's a music podcast I've always been trying to get off the ground, and I get overloaded with music, and I go a couple months and then it fails. Take sure. A break. But hey, I think maybe your guys' publicist or manager passed me along the album. Is it Risk?
Risk, yeah. I think, didn't you review that for your website?
Yeah, I think I reviewed it. And
we need to talk about that. Just kidding.
I liked it.
Okay.
I know I liked it. So, I think we met that way, and we've been trying to connect ever since then, I think. So.
Yeah, I think so, too.
So I'm glad it finally worked out.
Yeah, me too. Thank you for having me, and Happy New Year.
Yeah, Happy New Year. So ever since then, we've been, just kind of bullshitting on Twitter back and forth, I think, and eventually it worked out where you're able to, have some time, and...
Yeah, when you don't work, you can find time easily.
Must be nice. I'm jealous.
It's okay. it's stressful sometimes.
Yeah. So, well, let's talk a little bit about the band. I mean, your band's called the Trouble Starts. No,
I've
the Trouble
that.
Starts. That was totally unintentional.
You want to go ahead and start that over?
No, we're keeping that in. Trouble Starts. I apologize for the Freudian slip. But I think when you released the album Risk, was it just Daniel G. Harmann, or was the Trouble Starts on there as well?
The Trouble Starts were on there. The Trouble Starts kind of came about because I had a record out called Anthems from the Gentle War, and it was the last official solo record that I did. Uh-huh. And then when I went to start wanting to play those live, I wanted it to be a full band because the songs are like rock songs. And so I started assembling a band, and I was like, well, we're starting to play together and we're writing together, so let's just be a band. But I selfishly didn't want to lose kind of the credit that I had gotten from my, back catalog. It was right. All ego. And so so we basically chose And the Trouble Starts because that's one of the names of the songs on that record, and it was kind of a cool play on words. So we stuck with it. And then we recorded Risk as a band. We tracked that record live with vocals and guitar overdubs, but we just drilled it. And it was different than most of my recording experiences, which were kind of studio projects where I'd come in with something bare-boned and build from there, lay a drum track down and then just build. This was like solid songs that we worked over for 2 months before we went into the studio. And it was really fun and a great way to work. And that's how, I realized the beauty of both of those things now.
Okay.
And so we released that as Daniel G. Harmann and the Trouble Starts. And that was the first record that had the Trouble Starts moniker attached to it, even though only one of those people, Shay the drummer, is still in the band.
Okay.
And then for the most recent stuff, we've dropped the Daniel G. Harmann. They kicked me out.
They kicked you out of the band. I remember when I got the, it was Bear Trap PR was when mm-hmm. I first heard you guys. So I'm on their email list, and I love those guys. Like pretty much every band they send me is good.
Oh, it's amazing.
Yeah. They say, on all the marketing material, they call this, your sixth album. They're kind of putting you forward to kind of market you that way. So mm-hmm. you've had about before this five more solo type stuff. Was it?
Yeah. Roughly, I think six might have been a stretch. I had an EP and I think two or three full lengths, vice versa, maybe two. Yeah, I guess that's right. Two full lengths and two EPs, something like that, prior to Risk.
I actually haven't heard the I haven't heard your solo stuff, so we'll have to remedy that.
Yeah, let's take care of it.
And so you guys they kicked your name off the band, right? So the trouble starts.
That was kind of a mutual decision, actually. Yeah. You know, Will from Bear Trap kind of got the ball rolling on that, you know, because towards the end of the Risk campaign, it was like, listen, man, I think we could have got a lot more coverage had you not had your name attached to it, just because immediately you think folk band or,
okay,
you know, a jam band or something like that. And I kind of took that to heart. And as the songs for the new material developed, there were other band members stepping forward and taking even more ownership of their parts. And I was like, you know, this is a band and I'm just a piece of it. Mm-hmm. So we dropped it.
Yeah.
Right. And it kind of also gave me freedom to do my solo stuff without having to worry about stepping on any toes.
Right. Yeah. Well, I remember really liking the album Risk, and it was kind of, because at first I thought maybe this is a folky record, maybe this is like an alt country type thing was what I initially was expecting, but it was more like, I'm so bad at classifying, you know, styles of music, but it reminded me more of like Appleseed Cass mixed with Wilco type feel to it.
Yeah, that's kind of, you know, that's the stuff we love, and those are the records that I've always tried to make, you know, mm-hmm. weird and big. Yeah, and Appleseed Cast was always kind of a big influence, you know, Explosions in the Sky, a lot of instrumental, big, epic stuff. And that's definitely, you can hear it on that record.
Yeah. So you guys have a couple EPs that you guys have released. East was released last year.
In August, yeah.
Yeah, and I noticed kind of a style change between Risk and East. East seems a bit more, kind of maybe stripped down a little bit.
Well, it's different personnel.
Yeah.
With the exception of Shay, the drummer, we got a new guitar player who's a wild man, and a total shredder, and really great guitar player. And so, I think that I didn't want to remake Risk. I felt like I did the huge stuff, and mm-hmm. I thought that I could explore the realm of huge and epic without, you know, just overdubs and volume shifts. So we did that, and I think it worked. And the idea for the Risk, for the East-West combo was we recorded all these songs together as a project called Frontiers. And then we started to realize that the dynamic of the music world is shifting, and we can't market this record the same way that we marketed Risk or try to promote that, because
right.
everything's so like one song, okay, skip. And same, you know, with trying to send stuff to radio. So our theory was trying to stay on the radar constantly.
Okay.
Because
okay.
we still see bands today, Seattle bands, friends of ours, that are putting out a full length record, having a huge release show, spending a ton of money, losing a ton of money, going on tour for 2 years, and then doing it all over again. And that we've all done that, and that process is exhausting and expensive, and
yeah.
we just wanted to try a different approach this time. So we split it up.
Do you feel like as far as touring goes, that's not really a necessity these days, or?
I think that it's hard.
Yeah,
Obviously, I mean, I guess that's the understatement of the year, but you have guys like me that are almost 40, and a lot of the guys in the band are the same age. Everyone is married except for me. I have a girlfriend. One of them has a kid. And so unless something big comes up, it's not really like we're going to take it. I mean,
yeah.
I can always get in my car or get on a plane and do one-offs. But if we're just going to go down the coast with another band or something. Mm-hmm. But trying to do another nationwide tour where you're just a relatively unknown band that's getting some college radio support and some local press, it's brutal.
Yeah.
It's damaging to your soul in a lot of ways.
Do you feel like a lot more bands are taking less risks these days? Like your peers that are in the Seattle area, are they more worried about or focused on kind of the local scene now?
I think so. I've kind of, over the last couple of years, we as a band and me as an artist have kind of tapered off from the local stuff. We'll only take a handful of shows per year, and then try to focus our efforts elsewhere, especially with me being able to, you know, having a flexible schedule and being able to go out and promote on my own. I think that I'm not saying that it comes from getting no love from Seattle, but Seattle has known me for a long time. I've played here for a long time, and I'm excited to branch out. I'll always call Seattle home, but, you know, getting known in other markets is kind of more interesting to me right now.
Yeah. So the shift from the EP East to West musically, I haven't had my sit down, you know, let the music envelop me session yet with the West. I just, before we started talking here, had a probably about 15 minutes to blaze through the album after it Bandcamp. I was gonna say GarageBand. But I feel I can hear kind of that musical shift between East and West, whereas West seems a little more kind of laid back.
Yeah, I think it's in a lot of ways dark. It's darker, but also poppier. We put a lot of songs on East that we thought represented a certain feeling, and especially with this record coming out in the winter, like I said, they were all recorded in the same session, so they're all part of the big, you know, what's the theme?
Right.
But they definitely feel different. And to be honest, I love this record a lot more than the first one. I love that record, but this record just feels better to me. And we put a remix on there of one of the songs that was on East, done by the City Light guys.
Okay.
And we just love that the remix so much. We're like, you know, people need to hear this, so why not throw it on there?
Yeah.
So it's a nice change up.
Yeah. So what's your guys' plan from here? You're going to promote the EP, and what's the next kind of step for the trouble starts goes?
Right now, we have the record comes out on the 25th of February. It went out to radio this week. It's already been added to KXP and a handful of other stations. So we're going to hopefully do some in studios and then promote it as heavily as we can, and then probably just do the same thing, play a handful of shows and take the big shows that get offered to us. But everyone in the band has their own projects as well. So our guitar player sings and plays guitar in an awesome band called Gibraltar. The drummer and bass player, Shay and Kenny, both play in a band called Werebearcat, and they're both doing big things this spring. So I'm kind of taking a step back and working on solo stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm going to record a record with Brandon Eggleston in Portland, and I'm, you know, demoing all those songs at home and just spending a lot of time getting back to, like, the craft of writing. Because I feel like a lot of that has been lost with playing in a band, as weird as that sounds.
Well, it's a different animal. Like a band, it's a collaboration, you know, whereas writing by yourself is more that you're kind of, that's your blood on the page, you know what I mean?
Right, and I kind of want to just get back to how I know how to songwrite. As weird as that sounds, because I've been playing in this band for so long, not tracking anything and not demoing anything until I have solid ideas down, and then flushing them out once the demo is recorded before I go and actually track the thing.
Cool.
I'm excited.
Yeah, it's good. It's a good always be looking, I guess, looking forward to the next thing. It's funny because when in anything artistic, you know, it's almost like once you are done with a project and it's out in the world, you're moving on to the next thing.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the world is finally just getting a chance to really digest it, but you're already kind of moving on.
Yeah, I mean, East and West, or Frontiers, as we call it, was recorded 18 months ago and a year ago. We split it up. So we've all kind of moved on from there. But it's just kind of now we're giving birth to it.
Yeah.
So a lot of people don't understand how the machine works, or just because they've never really been exposed to it.
Yeah.
This has definitely been the longest time I've waited to release a record between stuff, but it's also been good.
Yeah.
It's given us a lot of time to think about where we want things to go.
That's cool. Did it kind of drive you nuts? I know, I mean, I'm on a smaller scale. Like, I've dabbled in bands, and I did an acoustic project with a friend of mine, and I've never had to worry about release dates. As soon as the thing's done and happy with it, I just put it out there.
That's awesome. That's and, the way it should be.
Yeah, but I mean, it's it's been a while. I mean, I'm, you know, being married with kids now. I don't have that time to create my and. But let's see. A couple of years ago, I found a disc with old unmixed files, and I had a chance to actually finally get vocals on them. So it was like, you know, it was cool to finish it, but yeah, I just released it when it's done, and it's different to kind of just sit on something and not release it. Does it kind of drive you nuts a little bit, or?
Yes and no.
Yeah.
I think that the solo stuff is more like what you're talking about, where I record it, get it done, get it out,
mm-hmm.
because I live inside my head a lot, and having a year between, you know, mixing a record and it actually coming out can be stressful. You know, you overanalyze and you listen and you're like, shit, what's this? You know, I would have done that differently, or, and I'm not talking big picture. I'm just, you know, the little things that we all kind of nitpick,
mm-hmm.
and that's definitely there. The longer spread you have between, you know, tracking, mixing, and then finally the record coming out.
Yeah. Well, cool. Let's play a song from West. The song that you guys have made available on your Bandcamp for download, the one that you guys are kind of giving out is Bird in the Water.
Yeah, and that's going to be available. Well, this is going to come out either this weekend or next, but that'll be available until the 28th for download, and then we're going to do another free download on the 28th.
Okay.
Of a different song.
And the EP actually releases, when's
February
the date?
February 25th. Yeah.
Cool. All right, we're going to play this, and we'll come back, and we're going to dive into more, say, philosophical things.
Yikes.
After this.
All right.
This is The Trouble Starts with the song Bird in the Water. You're listening to the AxPx podcast.
Don't know.
that was The Trouble Starts with Bird in the Water. It's off of their EP West, which comes out on February 25th. And so look for it on, you'll be able to grab it on Bandcamp. And I'm assuming it's going to be on iTunes.
Yep. It'll be available in iTunes for pre-order probably next week. And then, you know, full download on the 25th of February.
Okay. And I'm assuming also Amazon MP3.
Yep.
Well,
yeah, all the digital stuff.
Okay.
The East, we actually we have physical copies of that still available. They're
okay.
All hand numbered and hand assembled too. So.
What you guys should do is combine this into the Frontiers Package LP, if you know what I'm saying.
I know. Mm-hmm. Have you been reading my mind? Because we've been talking about that for a very, very long time.
Yeah.
So hope you kind of gave it all away there.
Ah,
right?
Damn it! Sorry about that. Well, as a collector, it's something that I would love. You know.
Me too. Like, so. my dream is always to have a record come out on vinyl, so that's what we hope to do with this.
Yeah. Let's talk vinyl.
Yeah.
I said we're going to, you know, move into stuff more philosophical, but it could wait.
That is philosophical.
I just recently, I think last year, I finally, after years of wanting to do it, finally bought a record player. And I had a few records here and there, but I finally jumped into buying vinyl last December. So a year in, and I love it. I absolutely love it. Do you people always say like there's a sound difference, and I'm not sure if I can really tell, just because I'm running my record player through my amplifier in my downstairs, you know.
Totally. And so I have a shitty neighbor, so I have to play stuff quiet.
do you ever now can you notice a difference in the sound? I get the physics of it and how, you know, how it should work, but
it's carved into wax.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Because my wife can't. She goes, I don't know why you buy these.
I buy it because I like the physical big aspect of it. You know, I grew up listening to records, the records I grew up with, I then inherited. To be honest, you know, I don't buy CDs anymore. I'll either download something or I will buy it on vinyl and then download it.
Yeah.
To download it now.
Yeah.
And I think it's more fun. I love, you know, gatefold and being able to like slide it out. And I just love the feel of it. And I'm sure the thing is, man, if I had an awesome stereo and I could listen really well without hearing, you know, a boat or the train go by, I'm sure I'd be like, yeah, that's way better. But I don't. I just like the process of it.
Yeah.
Taking it out, putting it on, stopping, flipping it over, I don't know, setting it on top so it looks, I don't know, it's just...
You have to display it.
Yeah, while it's playing, yeah. And I've been buying, like, all the Bruce Springsteen I can on vinyl.
Nice.
Because it's always cheap in places, and I love the boss, so...
So, yeah, I actually inherited a whole bunch of Bruce Springsteen.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, and I have, it's this old... I think it's one of his first releases, but it's like on a hand, not a hand drawn, but it looks like they drew the cover and then they copied it. And then they put it on there. Jersey Devil, something like that.
I don't know. I just know Greetings from Ashbury Park and all the big releases.
Yeah. It's
you got to take a picture and post that.
Yeah. It's great because it's basically just a recording of him playing in a bar.
Oh, and, that's awesome.
I'm trying to find an info on here, but it's pretty rare, apparently.
There was this video that came out last year, and maybe you posted it, of him playing at some shitty bar in Kansas City, like 3 years before Greetings came out, and it's amazing. Like, he plays two songs. He plays, not Rosalita, Queen of Arkansas, and one other song, and it's just so beautiful, and it's like, man, this is where it actually came from.
Yeah.
See, I love the process. I love, like, seeing, and that's why I'm kind of doing the demo stuff and then recording it, like, as a real record, is I think people are, because I am, I are interested in seeing or hearing the process of how records are made, how an original idea turns into something different or the same, only a little different.
Yeah. That's fantastic that Springsteen's great.
Oh yeah, he's my favorite.
And I love hearing. He's one of those guys you wish you can go back in time and see him play in some dive bar.
Oh man.
You know, just because the way he tells stories and just, you know, just pretty great stuff.
Yeah. Have you watched Lilyhammer?
You know, it's on my list of Netflix things to watch.
I've been watching it just because of Stevie Van Zandt. It's okay. But it was funny because they, like, the last episode I watched, they opened with Born to Run. Like,
oh, nice.
As the credits rolled, it was pretty awesome.
Well, let's dive into some other stuff. Something struck me when you were recently on the Mike Herrera Hour, and you guys went over time, and it was starting to get good when you guys had to stop, but the last half hour or so, you guys started talking about religion and kind of your background and things like that, and it turns out that we kind of have a similar background with your parents being, you know, very, very religious. You're raised up in a Christian family, and I'm sure you listen to Christian rock.
You know, DC Talk and MXPX.
Yeah. Oh, MXPX, huh?
Who?
So, yeah. I mean, it's interesting to see kind of the trajectory of Mike's faith. And he's not extremely vocal about it, but I kind of get where he's coming from.
Yeah, I had a hard time getting a gauge on that. You know?
Yeah. It sounds like it sounds like he's kind of, I mean, we're all about the same age, right? I'm 35. Mike's what, 36?
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm 37. I think he might be a year older than me.
Yeah.
I think, though, you know, I kind of have a theory about that. And even if he was, like, you know, went the Bazan route and completely decided to, you know, no longer be a believer, I think that'd be a huge step for him. Because they fly all over the place and play one-offs, and they, you know, they're playing to a shitload of Christian kids.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And so that would, for him to publicly say that would kind of probably be not what he would want to do.
No. I mean, I my jaw hit the ground when he admitted to smoking weed, and I was like, oh my gosh, you know.
Yeah, dude, we smoked a bowl together before we even did the podcast.
That explains
so
a lot.
Funny. Yeah. Well, yeah. But if you listen, I don't mean to plug it, but if you go to his, like, Tumblr page, you can actually listen to, it's called the After Hour or whatever, where the rest of our interview airs.
Okay.
And he plays one of our songs on there, I think.
So. Oh, he does. Nice.
Yeah.
That's nice of him.
Yeah.
So it's great, you know, that you had the opportunity to talk to him, and I've been trying to get him on the show for quite a long time, and it almost worked out. You know, on the podcast when you guys were talking, he mentions this show out in the middle of nowhere in California.
Yeah.
That was the weekend I was going to try to meet up with him, and he was thinking it was in L.A. when I was initially talking to him, and then I looked, and he told me where it was, and I looked on the map, and I was like, oh my god, that's...
Was it like in Joshua Tree or something?
It was crazy, yeah, it's out there in meth land. I mean,
oh,
just
right.
Middle of nowhere, so I was like, nope, I don't think I'm going to make it to that.
It's like where Face to Face is from, like Victorville or something.
Probably, it's something like that, but it was even more remote than that, so it didn't work out. I would love to have him on the show. One of these days, but you know, we'll see. Well, I'll start small with you.
Thanks, buddy. Appreciate it. Well, look at the time.
Yeah. Oh shit! That has ruined the. That has ruined it.
No.
So let's talk about it. I mean, so you're describe your, like, how the family you grew up in. I mean, what denomination were your parents? What was that? You know, youth group stuff.
Like. I grew up Lutheran, or I will say now, I was raised by Lutheran parents.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, going to church every Sunday, and it was always a chore, and it was in a very small town in Arizona, and we were one of the very few, you know, Lutheran families in a sea of Mormons.
Oh, okay.
And so, I think, I don't know if you're familiar with Lutheran doctrine or whatever, and it may have just been my crazy pastor at the time.
Yeah. I was raised Lutheran.
Really?
Yeah.
Missouri or Wisconsin Synod? Evangelical.
No, it's actually in the Bay Area. There's a Lutheran church there. I can't even remember the name of the church. Saint something's, you know, Lutheran church.
Like hymnals or rock band?
It was hymnals for sure.
Okay. So definitely the same type of shit. So.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we moved to Iowa. And we went to a small Lutheran church there. And then my parents got sick of the Lutheran thing, and I don't know if there was a difference in the, you know, the doctrine between the Lutheran churches, which there probably is, as you mentioned. but they didn't like that that one. So then we got involved in like an evangelical free.
And oh yeah,
kind of evangelical free.
I know those guys too.
And then I went to a Lutheran college. So
sure. Did anyway. You go to Concordia or?
No, it was a small Lutheran college called Waldorf in Forest City, Iowa.
Cool.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was a great school, very liberal, which I really liked.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. And I know that now, and I don't know, it must be the evangelicals, but I know that, like, Lutherans have somehow become, like, pretty open to gay marriage and stuff now.
Yeah.
I don't, you know, not the church my parents go to, but that's why it makes me think that it must be the evangelical side.
Yeah. Which pisses off the evangelical free denominations. Because they don't know we have evangelical and we're anti-gay, you know?
Yeah, exactly. You took our word.
Yeah, exactly.
But growing up there, being Lutheran, I don't know if you had the same experience, was, you know, very much you don't associate with other denominations. Because that kind of lets the devil in. And my parents were like, no, that's dumb. So I got to hang out with other Christian kids and so that's kind of how my story began is I met some kids at a big youth group thing at the Catholic church and then met a girl. We became friends. And then when I moved to Phoenix, I started working for her parents and they went to an evangelical free church called Faith Evangelical Free in Mesa or Tempe, Arizona. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how I got hooked up with like learning about hardcore and learning about, you know, punk rock. Cause I loved hardcore and I love punk rock, but I never ever imagined the two worlds meeting, you know, Christianity and rock and roll.
Right.
Right. And so I started going to like MXPX shows and, you know, Overcome shows and, Unashamed and all those old hardcore, you know, the first ever Tooth and Nail bands.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is awesome. And then a big shift for me was my best friend from high school, who grew up Assembly of God, came out, and I was like, "Whoa, this is! I never would have thought that." And then he started telling me stories about how, you know, since he was 8 years old, he would pray that, you know, God would take the gay away from him or take the sin away, and I was like, "God, that's fucked up." Like, and the more I thought about that, the angrier and angrier I got. And so I just started reading and for the first time in my life, you know, kind of thinking for myself because I'd been thinking the way my parents wanted me to think for 18 years. And so then I moved to Seattle and as my parents will say, you know, that's where I became a heathen. I mean, dude, honestly, like my parents don't even know that, you know, I essentially consider myself an atheist now.
Yeah.
Like I was telling Mike, you know, like my mom's biggest fear is that she's not going to see me in heaven.
Right.
So that's some heavy shit to live with.
Yeah.
As I'm sure you know.
Yeah. I mean, do you guys kind of leave it unspoken when you talk to your parents or do you just, you know, how's that work? How does like, you know, Thanksgiving dinner work if you guys get together?
They pray. It makes everyone uncomfortable. my girlfriend and I just kind of sit there. And then they drugged me to church on Christmas, this Christmas Eve this year. And the thing that made me the angriest, because I've kind of gotten into the place where I'm no longer super angry about it. I'm more like, oh, it's a fairy tale. You know, there's a lot of fairy tales that a lot of people believe. I'm just going to play along with this one and try to make the most of it, especially when I'm around my parents. So... the thing that pissed me off is that they didn't ask me to go.
Oh, okay. They just said, all right,
like, you're at our house. You were going.
Oh.
And so that's going to end. And it didn't really make me mad until I sat and thought about it. Like, dude, I'm fucking, you know, 40 years old and I'm being told to go to church with my parents.
Yeah.
But I don't think that that's uncommon, you know?
No.
Like I walk on eggshells a lot of the time. With them, and I, in a lot of ways, I think it's for their own good. You know, I don't want to break their hearts.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I hear that a lot. I mean, last year I interviewed quite a few people who came from a Christian background and you know decided not to believe anymore. And it seems like other than themselves kind of getting over this, all of a sudden, this change in thinking and all the stuff that that drags up, I think the biggest thing was this relationships with the families.
Yeah.
And some people, I think out of the three or four that I talked to, I feel it seems like that was a big deal.
they're shining it on like I am.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, it's unfortunate. I wish it didn't have to be that way. And I always think about, you know, me as a dad, I got three kids, and like how I'm, if they differ from my beliefs, how am I going to react, you know? And I always hope that I can, as I do with these conversations in the show, that just engage the conversation and kind of see where it goes.
Sure.
And let them come to their own decisions. But yeah, I mean, I was went through a lot of anger. I think last year was the first year I actually kind of gripped the bull by the horns, you know, and said, all right, I'm gonna face this doubt that I have, you know, and see where it goes. And I can say that I'm definitely less angry after getting through a whole lot of things. What
therapy has helped?
Yeah, I've thought about therapy. I've almost gone. I haven't gone yet. But has that kind of helped you get over most of the anger issues?
Absolutely. And yeah. My therapist is awesome because she kind of comes from the same boat that you and I do. I think she may still be consider herself Christian, but she's mm-hmm. very, very liberal and super progressive, and mm-hmm. and swears, you know, and knows that, you know, I have premarital sex and smoke weed and all that stuff, and there's absolutely no judgment there.
Yeah.
So she's been very, very helpful about, you know, just helping me become, well, not become, but how do I say it? Like express who I am, mm-hmm. but on my terms.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense.
Yeah. Well, I mean, would you say that you more identify more atheist? Do you feel your journey is done, or do you feel that the journey is never done?
No, I don't think it's ever done. And yeah. I think, you know, I'm a big science guy, and I'm always reading. And I wish that I had the library presented to me now that I do now that I did back then.
Yeah.
You know, being able to read like Richard Dawkins and all the stuff on Netflix that you can watch about, you know, space and stuff that actually makes sense. Because I eat that stuff up.
Mm-hmm.
I'm always watching and I'm always reading about that. I don't think the journey will ever. And my views may shift.
Mm-hmm.
I may find something where I'm completely comfortable living in both worlds, but I don't really see that right now.
Yeah. Yeah,
I'm not going to have kids, so I'm not going to face that.
Yeah, yeah.
The challenge that you, I don't know if it's a challenge, but that you do. You know?
No, it's a unique challenge. It's cool, like, because I feel like I have a better perspective, a kind of a more open-minded perspective than how I was raised. And I mean, my parents, I mean, I almost wish, I mean, they're very much more open-minded, and it's easier to talk to them now than it would have been, say, I would have been going through this, say, you know, 10, 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It would have been total hell to try to even bring this up. But their views have changed, and my dad doesn't necessarily even really believe in hell anymore.
Sure.
So their views have changed, and they're definitely more progressive in certain areas, but then they're more, you know, but then they're not in other areas. It's kind of unique for them, but
yeah, mine are too, and I think that I definitely think my parents will always be Christian. But as you know, the Lutheran Church is very kind of a big social thing,
mm-hmm.
especially for the older people. That a lot of them are just kind of waiting for the clock. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I go there, and I'm like, when I went with my parents, I'm like, geez, man, I'm literally the youngest person here, except for these other kids who are in the same boat as me, or just
right.
kids that were like, you know, 9 and 10 that were brought there by their parents.
Yeah. So your parents have always stayed in the Lutheran side of things.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Yeah. Cause mine, we, you know, went Lutheran, evangelical, free. And then now, they did non-denominational, and now they do more kind of home church, and they're in this, they meet on Saturdays now, because Saturday is the actual Sabbath. So there's like a blend of Jewish and Christian going on there.
And Seventh-day Adventist.
They're not Seventh-day Adventists. I always try to talk to them about it, and then there's way too much to unpack. And meanwhile, you know, the kid's in the corner pooping in his pants, and you know, I just don't have time.
Well, you're a better man than I. You're attempting it. You
know? Yeah. So I wanted to ask you, when you brought this up on Mike's podcast, this whole no having kids thing, did you just say, I'm not going to, you know what, I'm fine with not bringing any kids in the world, and then just go to the doctor?
Yep. pretty much. I mean, it was a very, my parents don't even know that. But they don't, that's the thing I'm going to tell them soon. But they know that I don't want kids. My sister doesn't really want kids. And I've never really had that craving, you know, to have a kid. And I talk to male friends of mine, and I'm always asking them, like, do you want kids, or did you want this kid? And they're all like, yeah, of course. And I don't have that.
Yeah.
And so a couple of years ago, I just kind of started getting this worm in my brain about, you know, well, maybe I should do something about that, you know, because I've, you know, been with dated girls and been in relationships with, you know, with women that have, you know, been on birth control. And I'm like, well, now I'm in a relationship with someone who's on birth control and who also doesn't want children. So it's time for me to man up and you know, and accept some responsibility. And so I did it. And honestly, like, I feel awesome about it.
Yeah.
I think the day of, I was like, Jesus, like a little bit terrified, you know, not to mention someone's messing with your nuts, but
Right.
The thing I dwelled on for a long time was the finality of it all, you know.
Yeah.
I knew that I wasn't going to be in 2 years or wake up the next day and be like, I want kids. I fucked up, you know. I think that just messing with your body in any way permanent always freaks me out, although I'm a guy with tattoos, so well, that one out.
Yeah. Well, it freaks me out too. I mean, we have three kids, and we both decided that we're not having any more. And I always dread. I haven't gone in yet. I know I need to go in and get the procedure done, and I dread just that phone call. I'm like, what is wrong with me? I don't want kids.
I think
To the doctor. Yeah, to get myself snipped.
It was, but just, you know, procedure wise, it was like one of the easiest things I've ever gone through.
Yeah.
And the recovery was like easy.
That's so. What I hear. I need to stop being such a big pussy about it.
Yeah. Mana.
Exactly. There's just no way that I will be sane with four kids. Like, there's just no way.
I don't know how you're sane with one, let alone three.
Yeah, you know, I've made it through.
But that comes from a non-believing dude with no kids. So. Take it with a grain of salt.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, for me, you know, my kids are awesome. I mean, we have a lot of fun, and yeah, it's hard. It's, you know, I have a friend, actually, Joey, who is the co-host for the show last year. He, you know, he doesn't want to have kids more from a, he doesn't want to, he thinks the world is so fucked up, he doesn't want to bring a kid into
right,
that world.
Right. No, I know that so, too.
Which is true. I mean, which is, yeah, you can definitely have an argument for that, but, for me, my personality, I mean, I come from a family of three. We have three kids, and you know, I'm really digging it. I love being a dad, and I don't think you know, I don't know. I like it, but like everyone's different, you know.
And well, I think for me, I just had to take a, you know, big look in the mirror and be like, I'm a selfish dude, and I want to play music for the rest of my life.
Yeah,
and I couldn't. Not that, and Mike and I talked about this, not that other dudes or women in bands can't do that. I don't think I'm that guy, you know? Like, if for some reason I was to tour for an extended period of time, I wouldn't want to be that asshole that's always gone.
Yeah.
So I accepted my selfishness and took care of it.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a, I saw a documentary called, what was it called? The Other F Word, and it's basically following along the singer of the band Pennywise. And because he recently, within the last couple of years, quit the band to focus on being a dad. So
it's the F Word fatherhood.
Yeah, exactly. So they have guys like Lars, I think it was Lars from Rancid, with his little kid. You have the dude from NoFX, lead singer of NoFX.
Fat Mike.
I don't know why I didn't think of that. But you know them and dealing with fatherhood and yeah, it's a you know if you want to pursue a career in music and have kids, and it definitely is a rough thing, and it showed how I can't remember the singer of Pennywise, but it, I mean he was gone. So they follow him for almost a year, and he was gone about maybe 290 days out of the year or something like that.
I so can do that. But.
So his kids grew, you know what I mean? Like
right.
From the start of the documentary to the end of the documentary, the kids looked different, you know? And so that was
like
when...
Like being in Iraq or something. Like coming home.
Yeah, I know. So,
their family. Yeah.
So I definitely see, like, if you want to be a full-time musician, you have... a decision to make on, you know, what you're going to do, like, you know, if you're going to settle down and have a family, and, you know, it is almost better for the kids to have both parents around if you can, so.
Totally, yeah.
You know, it's all good. So, I'm trying to think,
I'm like a deadbeat dad without the kids.
Yeah, exactly.
I want to be around.
Let's see here. I'm trying to think where we can go from here. I'm like, where did we end up? We're talking about.
You asked about the SNP.
Yeah, yeah.
And the doctor I went to is actually called Dr. SNP.
Oh here. Jesus!
I know, it's funny, and I got a pocket knife.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, that was part of like the gift that they give you is the pocket knife that says Dr. SNP, like drsnip.com.
Wow. That's crazy. So have you did you? Like, how much of your songwriting kind of goes into your personal kind of faith journey or you know, your disbelief? Do you put that into the songs? Do you, like, how do you approach songwriting from a personal level?
It's getting there. Uh-huh. I think that for a long time, I was like, you know, I wrote lyrics in the built-to-spill manner of, like, you know, I have a notebook and I have a bunch of words. Let's throw them together and then pull some shit. And then eventually it'll make sense. But now I'm actually, you know, kind of taking the journeyman approach and like sitting down and writing. And my idea for this next record was, in a way, although I hate the term, a bit of a concept record, just kind of about where I came from and, you know, where I came from. It's like I'm from Compton or something. you know, just my experience with, you know, with religion and faith and its impact on a small town. So I'm really trying to lean my writing towards that way. I struggle writing thematically, though.
Yeah.
I think I have a grand idea, and then the second I sit down to put the, you know, pen to paper, it just vanishes.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the hardest for me when I would try to write. I think the best songs that I've written were kind of just hanging out with the band and... they would start playing and I would start hearing words and I would write stuff down as the music's playing and we'd form the song. Mm-hmm. But whenever I sat down, like, I'm going to write because I wanted to I want to start writing again and I'm trying to sit down and choose a theme and I definitely want my personal kind of journey to go into it. But every time I sit down and nothing comes out, I'm actually better at abstract, trying to get abstract things down than I am trying to tell a story.
So. Right. And I did the same thing, you know, like, I think that was a big frustration with the band stuff for myself on a personal level was that we would write songs and then I would kind of, I would come up with melodies and then kind of put these place, I say it all the time, but like these placeholder lyrics in because the melody was awesome.
Right.
And then, I would go home and try to fill that gap and it was just impossible. So I would just struggle trying to write lyrics that matched that feeling that we got in the practice space. Mm-hmm. So I was like, well, I'm going to take some time from that and try to like get back to the craft of it. And that's what I'm doing now.
Cool. Well, I wish you all the best of luck with that. I'm excited to hear what you come up with.
Yeah. Do you want to, play one of those songs?
Yeah, we can.
Let's segue into that.
Yeah, if you have one available, go ahead and set up the song.
Yeah, so this song is called Anna, and it's about it's one of the new demos that I'm recording that's going to be coming out. Probably by the time this comes out, it'll be available on Bandcamp. So cool. It's about a hummingbird that died in my apartment.
So sad.
It's depressing. It was awful. I just found it hanging there. It came in to hibernate.
Oh.
I was staying at my girlfriend's house for like a week, and I came in, and it was just hanging there dead. It was awful.
So that's horrible.
Literally sat down and wrote. It was like instant inspiration, though. And so I literally sat down and wrote the song, like,
cool,
in an hour. And that shit never happens. And when it does, like, you kind of, thank God for technology, you kind of have to be able to capture it.
Exactly. All right, we're going to listen to this. This is Daniel G. Harmann with Anna on the AxPx podcast.
Songs and what you know, and what you know, come inside, it's warm, make yourself at home, and give those wings a rest. Branches lined with all your friends, your winter's rushing in. And did you know I met your cousin then? I held him in my hands, and everyone you know will stay so close. Rail wings bring you home, home, home. And everyone you know so close, and rail wings bring you home, home, home.
Well, that was today's guest, Daniel G. Harmann, with the song Anna. It's a song about a dead hummingbird.
Yeah. Womp womp.
I'm going to go hang up with Daniel and cry myself.
I'm going to go hunt. I'm going to go hunting. I got to go shoot my dinner.
Daniel, thanks so much for chatting with me today about, you know, music and opening up about your personal faith journey. I don't know. Faith journey. I don't know. Whatever.
I love
disbelief
that.
Journey. Whatever.
Faith Journey. That's such a good band. I think that's a metal Christian band, right?
Faith Journey. Yeah. I wanted to bring this up. I don't know if you've heard of it, but there's I'm gonna try to get a critic friend of mine on the show to talk about this, but there's a Christian horror movie called The Lock-In. Have you heard of this?
Shut up. No, where can I find it?
If you go to YouTube, type in The Lock-In Official Trailer, and you can watch the trailer. And it's found footage Christian, you know, Christian found footage film about guys who bring a porno mag, or as they say in the film, dirty mag,
nice,
to a lock-in. And apparently it you know, brings the devil in.
What's a lock-in?
Oh, well, a lock-in, for those of you who don't know.
What's a lock-in,
it's this
shop?
Thing that Christian youth groups do, where they take you to a gym, or most likely the church, and they lock you in the church all night long.
Oh.
And you have tons of fun, safe activities.
Oh, I guess that's what that thing was that I went to, where I met all those friends that then I moved to Phoenix. That must have been a lock-in, because it was an all-nighter. It was a rager.
Yeah.
Wow.
This is an all-nighter without the ecstasy.
With a dirty mag.
With a dirty mag. So, yeah. Yeah, I wanted to mention that. So Google that. I'll put a link in the show notes. And I would love to track down the directors and seriously interview them. And,
dude, that would be so awesome.
It may, I don't know. I'm sure they're nice people, but it may be, I kind of want to see what they're thinking. But
yeah, well, I would listen to that.
Well, thanks everyone for tuning in to the show. Again, this week's guest was Daniel G. Harmann.
Thanks, Sean.
You're welcome. And check out his music. Go to bandcamp.com/...
Let's just say, just go to thetroublestarts.com.
There you go.
That'll take you anywhere you want to go.
Thetroublestarts.com. Of course, there'll be links in the show notes on theaxpx.com. Follow me on Twitter at theaxpx. And you can follow Dan at Hello Tower.
Yep. Hello Tower.
Nice. All right, Dan, thanks again. And I'm sure you and I will be chatting up on the Twitters sometime.
About 15 minutes from
probably.
Now.
Probably. And then
watch the lock-in trip.
Exactly. And then, you know, hopefully in the future, if you ever make your way down to Southern California, you got a couch to sleep on for sure.
Thank you.
And, you know, definitely don't be a stranger if you come down this way.
Thank you so much. Same if you come to Seattle, man.
Definitely. I need to make a trip up there.
You should.
All right, everybody. I don't know who I'm talking to next week. I'm thinking Stephen C. Miller. He's the director of The Aggression Scale and a movie called Under the Bed. And his new movie, Submerged, is being edited by him right now. So I'm hoping to have that be our next show. Stay tuned on Twitter, the AxPx. All right, everybody. Have a great week. I'll talk to you next time.
Bye, Sean.